Hey, come on, Brother John. God bless you. We love you.
Thank you, Brother Jack.
Love you.
You know, had he asked me what my name was, I was going to say Little Bobby Leonard, assistant pastor of this church.
Amen.
I best just say who I am. I'm Brother John Jackson. Amen. We've sure enjoyed the meeting this week, and praise God for the fellowship, for the privilege to share the testimony and to preach God's precious word. Again today, we want to give the testimony. And I ask you to pray as we give this life's testimony that we be sure of one thing, that I do not give it again this morning as a matter of routine through dryness and just simple procedure, but that I have the anointing of God upon my heart. For souls are weighed in the balance, countless thousands of people across this land and around the world are lost without God. And I beg today that every mom, dad, every teenager, every boy and girl, give us, as we give this testimony, give us your undivided attention. Pray and listen, pray and listen. For it may be that some precious boy or girl, man or woman, may be in the need of being rescued today or being turned around for God's glory and God's praise. We read for the scriptures for today, for the testimony, from the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 11 and one verse from chapter 12. Beginning at verse 7 of Ecclesiastes 11. Truly the light is sweet, and a pleasant thing it is for the eyes to behold the sun. But if a man live many years and rejoice in them all, let him yet remember the days of darkness, for they shall be many. All that cometh is vanity. Rejoice, O young man, in thy youth, and let thy heart cheer thee in the days of thy youth, and walk in the ways of thine heart, and in the sight of thine eyes. But know thou that for all these things God will bring thee into judgment. Therefore remove sorrow from thy heart, and put away evil from thy flesh, for childhood and youth are vanity. Ecclesiastes 12:1. Remember now thy Creator in the days of thy youth, while the evil days come not, nor the years draw nigh, when thou shalt say, I have no pleasure in them. Or other words, I have no pleasure in my past life and the things that transpired. In other words, everything's gone asunder. I've done nothing for God, and I'm nothing today. Let us pray. Father, we ask of thee one special favor today, that we might feel the presence of our gracious God and our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. We desire to begin by praising and thanking thee for thy great salvation, for your mercy and your long suffering, and that while we were yet a sinner, that in due time your lovely Son died for our sins and the sins of the whole wide world. Give our bodies strength, refresh our minds, and take our hearts and melt them and mellow them into the divine blessed will of God. Our Father, as a result of this testimony and the grace of God, that someone be converted to thee today. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen and amen. I said this past night, as we preached for our brother in the Lord, I remember when I was just a little boy in a rural country home, how that the older members of the family would come in from the fields and work, would have a little break after the midday meal. There's an old China bear tree out by the corner of the porch, my country home, how as a little boy I used to like to lie on the edge of that porch and feel the cool breeze as the wind rustled through that old China bear tree. You know, I've heard the sound of wind, and the moan of the whistle of many freight trains in my life. I've heard the sirens of ambulances, the cry of suffering. But as I grow older, thank God, there's a soft wind blowing. The storms are beginning to settle down. And the clouds are beginning to move away. And somehow, we often say that I look for the Savior. Why, I believe it's so near, I've just quit looking and started listening. I just want to look upon the field. I want to look upon that vast place or that field of work or service that God would have me to do. I don't have to look for him, just listen. So one day I'll hear the sound of the trumpet. The Lord will call his precious church home. Oh, God, help us today. We give this testimony. Notice what it said. Rejoice, O young man, in thy youth, and let thine heart cheer thee in the days of thy youth. And walk in the ways of thine heart in the sight of thine eyes. But know thou that for all these things God will bring thee in the judgment. I'm glad that the judging hand of God, yet in grace and mercy, cut down the tree, but I'm glad he left the root in the ground. I'm glad that there came a time in my life that God stripped me of all that I thought I was, or from all the things that I did throughout my life. And you see, God mended my heart. Man lives his lifetime, his days in brokenness and sorrow and grief and misery. As I have written in the flyleaf of my Bible, but one day God took the broken heart and put a lot of glue in it. Took the broken pieces and put it together. And it'll never be broken again. I'm on my way to another world, shouting the victory in the Lord Jesus Christ. I've said many hundreds of times, I've never had all the answers for all the things that happened throughout my life as a sinner. And even some things that transpired after my conversion. Well, one day I shall skip down the streets of glory, walk into the palace of the king, and say, Lord, for a long time I wanted to be here. Just talk it all over. And let you tell me in your own words, why, Lord, why? I believe that he shall reveal to me the whole purpose of some of the things that took place. I'm glad and thrilled that I was born of poor parents. I'm glad that I was the son of a farmer and a farmer's wife who, by the grace of God, raised 9 children, lost one, the first child of the family, 10 in all. But I'm glad for an old-fashioned mother that knew God in a real, real way. I'm glad she was humble, though she was short and stout. But she knew how to shout the victories of God. She knew how to walk with God. She loved her God. And her mission field was her family. And through the sowing and reaping of the Word of God and the work of the Holy Spirit, they're all converted, born again. 2 of them are preachers, 1 a missionary nurse. The other one debating today for sure what another as to what God's will would be for them in the future. But when I go back and look over my life from the days of my birth, I'm still mystified. When I was born into this world on September the 9th, 1918, in a little small town of about 1,900 people in South Georgia, out on a dirt road about 2.5 miles from the little town of Doran, Georgia, called Cook County, I was born immature, sickly, and defeated as a result of my mother having double pneumonia during pregnancy. And when I was born in this condition, only to have the doctors tell my precious mother just a few weeks after my birth, a few days rather after my birth, that it was impossible for me to live, that my organs and my throat and the muscles were not even strong enough to take milk. I could not nurse from the breast, neither could I take milk from the bottle. But my mother had a God that knew how to work things out. And I know this, I was born in that condition for one reason, that my godly mother's faith may be tested to the limit and still stand victoriously, never having wavered, never falling by the wayside, never giving up. He that goeth forth with weeping, bearing precious seed, shall doubtless come again with rejoicing and bringing his sheaves with them. My mother asked God to help her work out a way that she could help me and nourish, give milk to my body. Back in those days, you could buy an eyedropper for just a matter of a few cents. And the Lord said to my mother, get an eyedropper. My mama took it and put warm milk in it, knelt down over my weak body, and placed it to the corner of my lip, and said, God, sanctify every drop of it. And let it do the work of God for your glory and praise. But still the doctor said I could not live. My godly mother that had family altar every day. My godly mother who corrected with the Bible. Who walked and talked about what the scriptures say. My godly mother, who in spite of almost dying twice in her lifetime with double pneumonia, taught Sunday school for 62 years and never missed a class. As I said on last evening, mother used to tell me about how that down at the old log church, 2.5 miles down the dirt road where my mother worshiped, how that the pastor used to take a two-horse wagon and a team of mules or horses, take one or two of the elder men in the church, and take all the elderly ladies' class down that dirt road. And if they knew my mother was sick, they'd meet early enough at the church to where that when Sunday school time started, they'd be down at my mother's house. They'd hand her that old-fashioned King James Version. And she'd lay up there, hardly be able to speak above a whisper. And she'd say, ladies, gather in. And they'd get down, some of them on their knees around a double bed. My mother would begin to weep and teach that blessed word. Many of those elderly ladies have told me later years about how they were converted through faith in the Lord Jesus Christ because of observing a consistent life in the Lord. Listen, folks, You'll win nobody to God by a half-hearted witness. And if you can't prove that you love your God enough to be faithful and loyal to Him, you'll never be a witness. My mother, shortly after she had devised a method with the eyedropper, came home from the Wednesday night prayer meeting at the old log church, walked in and bedded all the children down and said to my dad, "I am not satisfied. I'm going back to the old log church. I don't want anybody to go with me. I'm going down there and find the altar in the church. Me and my God's going to settle something tonight. In other words, I don't have to be upset and miserable. For God loves me. And God is not the author of confusion. My God will give me an answer." My mother carried me every day in one of my father's shoeboxes. It wore size 9 1/2. So I couldn't have been very big. And she took me in the shoebox and walked that dark night down that dirt road back to that old log church. Found the doors unlocked, didn't turn the lights on, felt her way down the center aisle. Found that old-fashioned altar in the house of God. And took a little dying bundle of clay, unwrapped it, pushed the blanket aside, and took my body out and laid me flat on the old-fashioned altar. She placed one hand over my heart, raised the other to heaven. And she's told me many times, word for word, what she prayed. She said, "Oh, God, back yonder when I was just a young 14-year-old girl, You saved me by Your grace. Now I have endeavored to the very best of my knowledge and ability to please You and to live for You down through these years." And said, "God, they tell me that my baby will die, but You're the God of the impossibility." And said, "Lord, I ask You that if my life has been pleasing to You from the day I got saved till this hour, that You have mercy upon my baby. You touch his body and heal him. And someday by Your wonderful grace, save him. And please, Lord, put him into Your service." Amen. And she said to God, "I shall never claim him again as mine. He's Your baby. And if You have mercy, I shall rejoice and praise You all the days of my life. But if my life is not measured up and You see fit to take him, I'll still praise God. I'll never accuse You, Lord. He's Yours. Take him, Lord." My mother walked back down that dirt road, little bundle of flesh. And I can remember as I grew a little older, how then in my early childhood, how did I they soon realize that I had rheumatism so severely that a couple of months out of the winter, in the morning, I would wake up like the rest of the family. I could only turn my head and move my toes and my fingers, but I couldn't make an effort to get up. I'd find myself wanting to get up, but there's just nothing happened. Oh, I remember that old wood stove in that kitchen that didn't have any overhead ceiling. Old hardwood oak floors where Mama used to scrub them and sing about the Lord. I can remember till this very moment her taking a little soft wool blanket, heating up that old oven, open the door and walk up and get it worn and pat it and feel and make sure it was just right. You mamas know how you want to get that little warm cloth just right, don't you? And she'd come over. My mother loved to sing. That's one thing I didn't get from her. I don't know how to sing. Never could, but I like to try. And my mother'd walk over with that blanket, kneel down by my bed, and begin to sing, Jesus is the sweetest name I know. Then big old crocodile tears flowed down her cheek. And she began to take those little tender hands. She had small hands like me. And she'd take those tender hands and begin to rub my body and begin to plead with God, Lord, touch it now. Lord, you do something for my baby. He's alive. A little bit, Mom could take me up and help me to the table. I remember how loving and gracious my brothers and sisters were. They never scolded or never acted like they was in a big hurry to eat, just quietly and reverently. They let Mama do her work for God. Many times I've watched her do that as a little boy. Look up in the midst of those tears rolling down that precious cheek. And in a little boy's way, I would say, my mama sure does love me. She sure does care. And I survived. I lived. I grew up. Went to school. But at school, I could not play like other boys and girls. The teachers would take turns. Staying, one would stay at recess this week. And another would stay at the lunch period. Somebody had to make sure they fed me. And at the evening break, and when the school buses began to roll off, they had to wait till somebody came for me to risk it for me to ride on the school bus. Too much roughness. But you know, I thank God for a godly teacher. I thank God that there's still some that believes in God and believes in the Bible. And I thank God for compassionate and merciful people. Had it not been for God's wonderful people, I'd have never made it. But I survived and I grew up. But it wasn't too long until, as I got a little older in grammar school, I began to hear the rumblings of older boys and girls in school and those in my class. They began to talk about that boy's old fanatic mama. They said she was crazy. They called her everything in the book. Hey, if you get on fire for God, everybody ain't gonna like it neither. And some of your very closest friends will begin to deny you.
That's right.
They began to tell me, my mom, who was just religious, Satanism, it's amazing how smart he is. You see, he wanted to penetrate just a tiny opening. See, if the scripture said, he that hath his mind fixed on me, him will I keep in perfect peace. What's going to happen to it if the devil comes in on it? It's going to be everything but peace. And gradually, he convinced me that my mother evidently was what they said. And I began to turn. I literally worshiped my mother because of the grace and way she had handled me and looked after me. But I began to turn from my mother toward my liquor-drinking dad, my Chesterfield-smoking father, my profanity-using dad, the big shot among the farmers, who thought he knew everything. Really, I love him, but he didn't know nothing. And so I began to desire to drink. and to learn the taste of whiskey. And I used to watch him as he take his whiskey bottle, and I'd make sure that I kept up with it. And finally, when it began to get down low, I'd know that it wouldn't be long till he was going to throw it in the trash can. And I made sure that as soon as he wasn't looking, that I picked up that whiskey bottle. And I imagined I was just like my daddy, a real man. And I'd turn it up and get those two or three spoonfuls. I'd walk across that sandy white yard barefooted. And I could do it almost perfectly. I'd pick up that cigarette duck between my big toe and first toe. I'd ease around back of the house or the barn and I'd smoke it. I soon learned that Dad was a chain smoker, and you know, I wanted to do it just like he did. Boy, I'd give anything if I could just cut loose just like he was then. But one day, God has an amazing way. I used to, after I got saved, I couldn't understand how that God could take evil and make good come out of it. You may say, preacher, I don't believe that. All things work together for good to them that love the Lord, to the called according to his purpose. And what are you going to do with that? And so I began to worship and began to idolize my daddy. My father was bow-legged. My father walked pigeon-toed. And I can imitate him to the letter. And as a little boy, I began to walk pigeon-toed and bow-legged. I mean, I never dared take a step like it, unless it was like daddy. By the way, your child's got a right to believe that you're right. Because after all, God did make you as the one that's supposed to be the living example to them. They couldn't learn to talk if some parrot didn't teach them. They'd never learn to walk unless some parrot instructed them. And so I turned completely, and I began to fail in school. All my grades went down to nothing. I was a failure. But one Saturday afternoon, my dad was a farmer and part-time railroad engineer. He and a friend that he worked for on Friday nights and on Saturday at a grocery store bought him a pint of moonshine whiskey. And they shared it together, 50-50. My dad's best friend lay in the hospital better than 3 weeks and almost died. My dad lived 3 days and died because of poison whiskey and smoking cigarettes. 3 days later, in the home, in the living room, in the bedroom of our home, the old-fashioned country doctor loved my mother devotedly. And old Dr. C.B. Slocum stood with tears rolling down his cheeks and said to my mother, Miss Clara, he can't make it. And old Dr. Slocum wept and said, if only John had never smoked. He's a chain smoker and his lungs are so coated with nicotine and tar. He has now developed double pneumonia. And said if he had never smoked, he would make it. But there's no other way, he's gone. He'll be dead in a little while. Well, it broke my mother's heart and this family's heart. You see, my dad was my God now. Remember, my precious daddy to this little boy, he was my God. He was all I had to live for. God was going to snatch my idol away. Finally, my dad called my mother to the bedside and said, I want you to gather all the children around the bed. Get up real close where you can hear me. And there I listened as most of the children lined up one side, but my mother and I were on the opposite side. As a little boy, I could look in his eyes and look in his face and see the trembling and the fear. I knew something was wrong. He said these words with tears rolling down his cheek. He said, honey, I'm sorry for the way I've lived, the way that I've treated you. I'm sorry I've never been to church with you. I'm sorry I never sit on the pew with the children. But listen, I had never in all my life, till the moment he died, I had never heard my daddy sing. I had never known my daddy to go to church. I've never sat in a worship service beside my dad. I've never known my dad to pray until that day. And he must have done his praying silently. It was only after he got his answer that we heard from him. And he said, I have sought God from the very depth of my heart, only to find that God will not hear my prayer. Somewhere, he said to my mother, somewhere out yonder, I've crossed over the line. I've trampled over his blood until he will not hear me when I pray. And if you challenge the statement that I've just read, you better turn over to Proverbs chapter 1. Read it real close, honey, and let it sink in. When your care and desolation comes as a whirlwind, then shall you call upon me right early. But other words, because you hated knowledge and you hated wisdom. Therefore, when your fear and desolation cometh as a whirlwind, and your destruction as night, I will not hear thee, because thou hast refused. Thou hast said it not all of my counsel. You wouldn't listen. In other words, I believe God was saying, your precious wife has desperately tried through the marriage and rearing of 9 precious children. By first of all, by way of example, she's walked with me, she's talked with me, she's followed me. She has used the book of instructions, the Bible. And you've said no for years and years and years and years. I don't have to have you, John. And my daddy related to my mother how he was going. He said, I'm dying. I know I'm dying, and I know I'm lost, and I know I'm cut off. And I can remember with my hand across my dad's left hand, Mama had his right hand across his heart and holding it and weeping. I heard my dad say the 3 last things I ever heard him say. He, in desperation, he said twice, I'm going to hell. Born of such fear. He said again in a little weaker voice, I'm going. Finally, his eyes bulged out. Satan was there waiting. He was reaching with outstretched arms, no doubt saying, ha, 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 boy, you see who's the victor. My dad trembled and said these last 3 words. Only one word changed. I'm
Inhale. He closed his eyes and died. 2 days later, we went down to the cemetery. And I watched my God be let down by big, strong men in the heart of the earth. And a little boy that had been nurtured from that condition when that I was born died with his daddy. Oh, daddy, hear me out here today. You that don't have no testimony. You that have never cared for spiritual things. And don't even love your youngers enough to follow God. You let them plunge off into hell or watch you go off into hell. And they'll pay a terrific price for it. And I saw my dad gone. I couldn't hardly stand it to watch that casket disappear beneath the sod of the earth. And God knows when they throw the first shovel of dirt in. I tell you, I died. I lost all hope. The teachers tried desperately to help me. But I had no more peace, no more joy. And when the term was over, it was a failure. I fought desperately for about 10, 11 months to get a hold of myself, but I couldn't. So one day, late one evening, while my darling mother wasn't looking, that precious God-fearing, loving mother wasn't looking, I slipped a little old cardboard suitcase out of the closet that had holes on each corner at the top. I took a little pair of striped blue jean overalls, a couple of little work shirts, no underwear, no shoes, no hat, no nothing. And I walked out that little country home where God reigned. Walked away from the family office. Walked away from everything that could have helped me. And I started down that same little road that went by that little log church I'd been brought up in from birth. Looked over the rails into the little creek where my father had a small private pond. It rained the day before, and I watched some little red-eyed fish trying to make their way up into Dad's pond. And I talked to them. I said, bye-bye, little fellas. I'll probably never see you again. And I stood out on Highway 33 between Camilla and Moultrie, Georgia, in South Georgia. Hitchhiked my first ride. Headed for Atlanta, Georgia. Little did I know that in the next 10 years, little did I realize the plan, the master plan that Satan had for me. Little did I know within 5 years I no longer could cry. Little did I know that he would give me the ability, if I thought of mother, to turn her off like you do a radio when you're tired of listening to the program, and in one split second have my mind somewhere else. You see, my mother was too close to God. Satan didn't want me to dwell on her. I couldn't have took it very long. And if you had told me that for the next 10 years, I would have become what they called in those days, many people call me the baby hobo, the youngest man to ride the rails they'd ever known. Hobos taught me how. They soon learned that my health still was not good. But they learned me the art of hobo, and they trained me as good as any football coach could train his players. And by the time I was 14 or 15, I could catch a freight train moving 30 to 35 miles an hour. I learned every signal that engineers know, that every flagman knows. every detail about a freight train, about a boxcar. I knew when the signal said we're coming in. I knew when they blew the signal and called for us, hit them out. Other words, we're only slowed outside the yard switch. We're calling for a highball signal. We're going to move, we're going to pick up speed, and we're not going to slow down. I knew when they gave the signal that they were coming into the freight yard and to throw the switch. I knew from the railroad policemen many times back in those days, the idea was for heaven's sake not to lock them up. The city didn't want them. In the Depression, there was too many of them. The railroad's best method was to help them get on the boxcar and get them out of town. So one of the best friends I had over the years was the railroad dick policeman. They'd tell you, if you need be, how long before the next train would come. Where's the best place to catch it? Where the ground's the most level? But if you had told me that for the next 10 years I would have traveled to every state in the Union except some 5 or 6, that I would have gone to Canada, Alaska, to every island in the Caribbean, to Central and South America from border to border. And yet in all those 10 miserable years, the longest I've ever stayed anywhere at one time was 3.5 months with a deputy sheriff from Fort Wayne, Indiana, who was the kindest man I've ever known. Remember, I wasn't arrested. He picked me up. He'd been going down south on vacation. And I flagged him. I made the mistake, I thought, at first, of flagging the deputy sheriff. But the only reason I stayed with him, I thought he had the prettiest daughter about my age I had ever laid my eyes on. And I blew a harmonica. So I said, I'm going to win her. And before I ever got to Fort Wayne, I had a friend. And she started in on her mom and daddy to let me stay with them. And I stayed some 3.5 months. But I soon found out the deputy sheriff was a Christian. I soon found out the mother was a Christian. I soon found out the little girl was a Christian. But I never had people next to my home in all those years to love me like they did. And by the way, thank you, you folks that handle gospel tracts. I went 10 years as a bum and nobody ever handed me a gospel tract. I had been in the ministry some 4 years before anybody ever asked me if I was saved. That's why they're going to hell. One of the reasons. One day I became restless. And I lied to the deputy sheriff. I said, I'm going down to the corner drugstore and get a Coca-Cola. He said, fine. Said, be back. Not later than 9, family altar. I made my way out of Fort Wayne and on my way. And I traveled in most of the states. I've been in most states in America as much as from 2 to 4 times in those years. But you know what? I never wrote a card. I never made a telephone call. I purposely made sure I never came down through Georgia. In central and middle Georgia, I always went down the coastline, Jacksonville, Savannah, that area. I was afraid I might run into somebody that knew me. Back home, the same darling little short chubby mother that used to go to that old log church, no fashion preacher, snow haired and white, in to raise his voice and preach the word of God. And that darling mother would grab that white handkerchief out of that big old black pocket. She'd get on a shouting spree. I mean, she'd start taking off all over that log church. And old Brother Thompson, I can remember as a little boy I was sick, and I had to sit close to Mama because I might need attention any minute. No, how I learned, if that old right hand ever started fumbling around that old back pocket, I knew Mama was fixing to shout. I knew she was hunting that big old white handkerchief. And that she whipped that thing about five or six times, I'd see old Brother Thompson just back off. He'd say, let her go, folks, says Miss Clara's in another world. She's going to have her spell, and I ain't worried about it. And when she gets through, I'll finish the message. You know what most folks done? Says, shut up and sit down. But she got to going for God. Now I remember that. So I reached a place that the average length of time in any city, anywhere, was 3 days. When by the time the third day would come, I'd become restless. I carried a coin all those years that nobody could have got, and I'm glad I never lost it. I'd flip it and I'd name two cities, just whichever come to my mind. One on the east and the west, or one on the north and south. And whichever way it fell, that was the only desire I had in life. And I was bound and determined somehow to get to that city. Only to get there and become restless in a couple of days and be on my way. That went on for 10 years. And I'm amazed nobody, even the deputy sheriff, never tried to show me how to be saved. But you see, God was working. Back down there in South Georgia on that little farm, as a little chubby mother that had said, God, they used to tell us, say, Ms. Jackson, why don't you face up to the realization of the fact, and that is that that boy was sickly. He had to be helped all the days of his life from the cradle to school, and there's no way he could have survived all these years. My mother used to look him right straight in the eye and say, you just don't know the power of my God. Yeah. Said, I walked down a little dirt road to an old log church one windy night.
Yes,
I took him in his daddy's shoebox, that special little blanket I made for him. And I walked into the darkness of the corridors of that little church. I took that boy out of the shoebox and laid him on the altar. And said, I know God left me a token that he's a working on it. I had him 12 years. And God not going to deceive me and keep my baby 12 years. And I know that one day God's going to save him. And I shall see him again. And I know that one day he'll be in the service of God. I went for 10 years. One day I was in Detroit, Michigan. God was moving. I caught a freight out of the freight yards of Detroit. The coin had fell for Houston, Texas. I wound up in Houston, Texas on a Saturday afternoon about 3 o'clock somewhere approximately. That afternoon it began to sleet and snow. Of course, I had faced those conditions many times. Hot weather in the summer, cold weather in the winter, raining in the fall, what have you. I had lived under all kind of circumstances. I had slept in rescue missions. I slept in the woods. I slept under bridges. I'm not trying to give glory to self, but if there's any one thing I want you to see this morning, I want you to see the results of a God-fearing, uncompromising mother. And a God that sits on the throne and his eyes go to and fro, watching up and down what's going on today. Satan ain't got nothing on God he's looking to. He ain't never fooling. And God had begun to work. I walked up and down that alley. The shoes that I had on at the time, I'd had others like it. I'd done packed cardboard in them till it wouldn't stay no more. It holds about like a silver dollar in both shoes and toes that turned loose. I couldn't get in the neat that day, and I usually was a genius at it because I was small and little and sickly and didn't take me long to get a meal. But God made sure the door was shut that Saturday. God made sure there wasn't no rescue mission nowhere around. It was there, but I didn't find it. And the nearer night fall came, the worse the weather got. So I found myself in a back alley. I was looking around to see where I could anchor in for the night. I found a garbage can down at the end of the alley, a big old round garbage can. Looked like it was pretty new. So I sat down on the side of that garbage can, took my old coat and pulled it up over my head like this. My old hat with the water and the sleet dripping off. But you know, God had a way of doing things. Right at the foot of that tub, there's a hole of water. Just deep enough to where that I had to sit in a miserable position on that garbage can. I couldn't quite rest my feet down like I wanted to. You couldn't sleep like that. But I'd made up my mind to tough her out. And with nothing else to do till morning, I began to gaze through the misty rain. And on my left, I remember the rear part of business houses. On my right, I began to detect that there was old-fashioned, two-story, colonial-type homes. On the right side, and there was two or three lights in the back of some homes down the way. But the one nearest me, I got to watch it. And I said, yeah, there's just one little drop cord with one little bulb. And all of a sudden, I saw a figure come between the light and me. And directed, come back by again. Mind you now, for all these years, Satan had blotted my mother out. I had long forgotten what the telephone number was. In that old crank phone down on that little farm in South Georgia. And all of a sudden, I cried out loud, that looks like Mama. Boy, I hadn't said that in years. Satan lost his power that night. The prayers at the altar many years ago were still active in heaven. The Revelation tells us about the prayers of the saints on the altar of God. And all of a sudden, these tear glands that had locked and hadn't cried in 5 years busted wide open. Uncontrollably, the tears mingled with rain and sleet began to flow down my wicked face. All of a sudden, the Holy Spirit began to convict and convict and convict. And as I looked at that little frail woman going back and forth, I said, you know, if I was at home now, of course, I was going back to my childhood. If I was at home now, Mom would be fixing breakfast about now, warming up some biscuit, fixing me some scrambled eggs and sausage. All of a sudden, I could see her stand by that old wood stove. Jesus is the sweetest name. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. You see, I can't remember song. I can't even sing Amazing Grace through the first stanza unless I got the book. All of a sudden, I slid off the garbage can, right down in the mud. I didn't know how to pray. And so I decided I'd pray just like my mama did. So I lifted up my hand and I cried out and I said, "Oh God, if you're real, if there really is a God like my mother knows, and there really is a man named Jesus that can save and change a man's life like my mother's, I'm desperate and I'm hopeless. Ain't no way unless you do something." God set me free. I forgot about my wet clothes. I forgot about my shoes with holes in them. I forgot about sleep. I forgot about my stomach. And all of a sudden, I was just like my mama, running up and down, shouting, and praising, and rejoicing. Hallelujah. And that went on continuously from 4:30 in the morning until about 7:45. It's a wonder the Lord didn't come get me. But God put a holy host around that boy. I was a new creature. I watched little man come down the street and walk to that grocery store. First thing I thought is he's fixing to open that store on Sunday. He ain't got no business opening on Sunday. That's a strange way for me to be thinking in a split second, ain't it? And I said, "You know, but God got to have somewhere for me to use telephone. I don't understand it." And one day I will. But I give him time to get open and get his cash register. You see, I wasn't as dumb as I'm out of look in some things. I done scheme away too much. But I watched him, and when I knew he settled down, I walked in. I asked him, I said, "Sir, can I use your telephone for a moment?" He looked at me with my beard and my ragged clothes and said, "Yeah, if you got the money." I said, "No, sir." I didn't say it bitter. I said it in sweet spirit. See, if God changes a man's life, he changes it. You're either changed or you ain't right. I believe in instant salvation. I mean so instant, I believe it's quicker than the twinkle of an eye. When the conditions are met, God's never late. No lost motion, no lost time. He says to his son, "It's done, boy." He says, "And I moved out of the realms of a pauper and a beggar into the palace of the king. I might have had on ragged clothes, but I was clothed in royalty. I exchanged the title from a bum to a blessed ambassador for the Lord Jesus Christ. I became a representative of another country. And boy, I'm still representing that country. Abraham looked for a city which has foundation, whose builder and maker is God." And I said, "No, sir, I don't have any money." I said, "Sir, I just want to call my mama." And I said, "By the way, is that your garbage can back down the end of the alley?" He said, "Yeah, why?" I said, "You know what happened down there about 4:30 this morning, 34. He said, "No, what?" I said, "Man, I got born again. I got saved." He looked at me and said, "You what?" I said, "Yes, sir, mister. I got saved. And I've been gone from home 10 long years. And I want to call the sweetest little short chubby mama a man's ever had and tell her prayers are answered." I remember going up to that old store, and it had the old crank phone, too. And this is what gets me. Satan had trained me to forget mama's phone number. But God moved in and opened it up.
And it was as clear as if you had printed it across my hand. I walked over there that morning and dialed that old wall telephone. I heard way down in South Georgia, all the way from Houston, Texas, that early in the morning, I heard a little voice say, "Hello?" Well, my heart was about to bust out. I said, "Mama?" And when I said, "Mama," you ain't never heard a shout like that in all your life. I just had to stand up and hold the telephone on. Just hold it on. Finally, when I could tell she'd quieted down, I come back on the phone. I said, "Mama." And she said, "John, where you at?" And I said, "Mama, I'm in Houston, Texas." And I said, "Mom, you don't have to worry about me no more. I'm through riding freight trains. I'm through bumming and begging. And sometimes I fail to and leave this out. And if I blurt it out, I don't think I mentioned it the other day. But I blurt it out. And I said, "Mama, I'm glad you took me to the altar when I was a baby." I said, "Mama, I'm saved. I'm coming home. I'm coming home." She shouted again. When she got kind of calmed down, she said, "Son, do you have any money?" I said, "No, Mama, I don't have any money." She said, "Well, please tell me where I can send you some, sweetheart, so you can come home." I said, "No, Mama, you and I have got a great God. Now, I don't know how to explain it, but I believe God will let me ride one or two more freight trains." And I said, "Mom, I ain't gonna beat nobody out of nothing. I ain't gonna beg for nothing. I'm coming home, Mom, changed, born again." And she said, "God bless you." I rode two freight trains. The last one wound up in Birmingham, Alabama. I hitchhiked from Birmingham, Alabama to Atlanta, Georgia. I got out and caught a ride on what used to be the old U.S. 41, which is now 75. 98 miles from my home. Early one morning, I'm going back down that little dirt road I walked on 10 years before. I crossed that same little old narrow wooden bridge, and I remember them precious little old fish. I walked over and looked for them. I said, "I'm right, fellas." I said, "Y'all gone." But I said, "I'm home. I'm home." Walked up that gradual hill. It wasn't a steep hill. But as I got close to the house, I watched all them old oak trees and the old pecan trees where my brothers and sisters had got out from the lowest limbs down to the bottom of the trunk, and they'd painted them snow white. They'd gone down to the woods and cut down them old gallberry bushes and made homemade brooms out of it. They'd swept the yard clean. I said, "Yeah, that's what Mom and the family's done for the old prodigal." You say, "Welcome home." I walked up and knocked on that old door of that house. Never had a drop of paint over it in 40 years. I saw that knock turn. Boy, my heart, I didn't know whether I could stand it or not. I saw that door open. Here come a little chubby mother, little short, fat, chubby mother. Hair that used to be so beautiful and curly, jet black. Such beautiful, precious blue eyes and clear face. Not a wrinkle, but that day I saw snow white hair and a face filled with wrinkles. And I said, "Oh, God, that's what my dad did to my mother." And we embraced. And I said, "Mama, God has forgiven me. Can you find it in your heart to forgive me?"
She said, son, you'd not got 50 miles away before I missed your little old cardboard suitcase. And I missed your little old broad, and I knew my boy was gone. Instead, they used to tell me, that I may as well face up to truth, that I couldn't have survived in the condition I was in when I left home. But said, I used to tell them every time they'd mention it, you just don't know the power of my God. God let him stay with me 12 years, and I've always believed he'd come home saved. My mother died in 1968, December the 16th. Oh, I wish I could have been at the bedside, but what a difference from the bedside of my mother, from that of the bedside of my dad. Mom called my younger brother, my baby brother, who's a preacher. She couldn't see any of the family anymore. She'd had a severe heart attack. She lived about 4 hours. This is the testimony that my brother gave me at the funeral home. As soon as I got there, I didn't make it. Mom passed away before I got there. And he said, John, said Mama couldn't see any of it. Said she called us all around the hospital bed at Marine Memorial Hospital, and she made the roll call. Started with my oldest sister, and I'm in the middle of the family, but somehow Mom skipped over my name. And she got down to the bottom, and she paused a moment, and she said, Clovis, is my little preacher boy here? Clovis said, no, Mama. We've gotten John the message. He's not here. But we've been informed that he's gone over to Fort Valley, Georgia, to try to get a broken home together. Said my mother paused for a moment and smiled. And said, ain't that just like my preacher boy? Did he be working for the Lord? And she said, son, tell him when he gets here, I'm sorry I missed him. But tell him I'll be sitting on the front pew in glory, just waiting for his coming. I'll live to preach in the old log church. I live to see my mother sit on the same pew that I used to sit on with her when I was a baby. I live to see the old white handkerchief go again. Not to hear Brother Thompson preach, but to hear a baby preach. And just before we give the invitation, I used to not do this because I was afraid people would make fun of me. But I do it out of a grateful heart, because you know she's listening. Yeah, Mama. She's listening. Right up on that front pew. Sitting down, no doubt she'd invited the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords to listen in.
Hallelujah! Hallelujah!
Mama, thank you from the depth of my heart. Thank you for not giving up. Thank you for living such a wonderful, beautiful life. Thank you for the many years you took the warm blanket and rubbed my body. Thank you for the tears. Thank you for the sausage and the scrambled eggs and all that. I'm saved, and you know it, Mama. Yes. Thank you. Yes. One day, one glorious day, babe, yes, I'll be there with you. Yes. Thank you again, Mama. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. Oh, as we stand, I'd like for us to sing a special song. As we stand this morning, please don't leave. Stay till it's over. I don't think anybody's that hungry to you. How in the name of God could we prefer physical food to this spiritual food? But I want our brother to lead us in a song that was written in my mother's living room floor. many years ago where we'll never grow old. Where we'll never grow old. And while we sing that invitation, let me beg of you, moms and dads, listen to me real close. If you have not been the leader for God that you need to be with your children, and today they're astray and in the world, don't blame God. You can rightly take part of the blame yourself. And so, my friend, if you failed your children today in spiritual matters, and you've led the wrong example, you haven't been to God's house like you ought to, you haven't been consistent in Sunday school, you don't know what family altar is, and you've not been true to God, you owe God an apology this morning. You need to get out on your knees and pray and confess. And as we begin to sing, you come. And if you're here and you're not saved, for God's sake, get saved. Oh, God help us. God help us. If you need to be saved, come and get down and make it known. Yes. Come on. If you're lost, if you're lost, listen to me. Boys and girls, if you're lost. Men and women, if you're lost. Teenagers, if you're lost. Don't gamble with God. Don't waste another moment. Come while there's opportunity for life. Come while God will set you free. Come on. Oh, I believe that somebody needs to be saved. I believe God. Yes, David.
In a land where we'll never grow.
Come on. If you're lost, please come.
Never.
Somebody here that needs to be saved.
We will never.
And God knows who you are. And God got his finger on you. If you'll just say yes to God, God will save you from a lot of misery down life's road.
Happy praise to
God. God will forgive you for your failures.
Through eternity, sing.
Come on, whosoever will, let him come.
In a land where we'll
preachers, we need to be examples to the flock. Come on.
Never.
I mean, we need to die to self and come alive to God.
Never.
While we pause for just a moment, if Jesus in his royal robe entered into the front door this morning, could he reach and point toward you and say, peace be still? Do you have peace that passeth all understanding? Do you have burdens too hard to bear? You have problems, heartache, and misery. Move out. We're going to sing another stanza and give you an opportunity. If you're not saved, don't play about this religion business.
When
I mean, don't make a mockery of it, but get out and confess your sin and repent for God.
And our life crown is won, and our troubles and trials are
over. Come on, move quickly. You see, my dad said, I'll wait. It's too long. And you don't know where that too long is.
The ones who've gone on before. Never grow old. Never grow old. In a land where we'll never grow old. Never grow.
And if you need to stay at that altar, you stay there. Don't you dare shortchange yourself and leave, because you know that God's met your need. you're a Christian, make sure he's met your need. If you're a backslider, make sure he's met your need. If you're lost without the Savior, make dead sure you get saved. No put on. I mean, this is a salvation day. Come on. While these folks are praying, let me remind you that there's about 15 tapes left out in the vestibule. That's all we have. The rest are gone. If you feel like purchasing one and passing it on to a friend, just leave your offering there on the little case. But oh, we're interested in somebody moving to God. Yeah. This is a love feast, isn't it? This is just taste of what it's going to be in the next world. Just a little bitty sniffle of it. The honeydew's dropping from the honeycomb. The bees have gone out for the nectar today. God kissed the flowers. And it's beauty. There may be somebody saying, I wish they'd sing just one more. Land. I was almost on ready to come. Almost is not enough, but come.
Is a beautiful home of a soul. Built by Jesus on high. There we never shall die.
God for folks who just cling to God. Just keep clinging. Well, it's been sweet, hasn't it?